Hi, good morning to all of you. I hope you are all well and safe at your home, and I hope you are staying inside. Please stay inside. And I do believe you have already started working on your manuscript, and a lot of useful information has already been shared with you regarding the same. So I am going to talk about today how to prepare figures and tables for your manuscript. Now, you must have been through a lot of research papers and review articles by now, and you must have seen a lot of schematic representation, flowcharts, diagrams, graphs, etc. So I am going to brief you in this video about how to make diagrams easily. So let's get started with it. You can do this, diagrams and schematic representation easily by using PowerPoint or Photoshop. But personally, I prefer PowerPoint presentation because most of us are already acquainted with it, and we've been using it for a very long time. While Photoshop is a little less user friendly for the beginners. So if you're like a pro for Photoshop, please use it. But if you are not, then I suggest you start with PowerPoint. Now, most of the journals will require a diagram for 300 dpi, which is dots per inch. Now, more the dots, merrier the picture. This is a demerit for PowerPoint because the default slide for PowerPoint will give you a resolution of somewhere around 92 dpi. And on the other hand, Photoshop will let you switch between resolutions. You can always change it. In PowerPoint, you cannot do this. If you have made a low resolution picture, there is no way you can actually go to a high resolution. So in order to achieve a high resolution picture in PowerPoint, we need to change the size of the slide, right? You can think it as, in a layman terms, you are stretching the canvas, right? And you're making the image. So even if it is like decreased in size, you will still be able to see everything clearly. Now, this is done because most journals will fit your figures later on, and they'll stretch it or shrink it. And if it's a low resolution picture, the chances of it becoming hazy or unclear is more. So they require a high resolution picture. So I'll first tell you how to change the dimensions of your PowerPoint presentation. You need to open a PowerPoint, right, and select on blank presentation, and your screen will be like this, right? Now you have to select the design tab, which is the third tab, and on the design tab, the second last option says slide size, right? It's a drop down menu. You have to select the third option from it, which says custom slide size, right? When you click it, it's going to give you a pop-up menu. The pop-up menu will have different numbers over here. So you just have to change them to 100 centimeter each and then press on OK. And it will give you a new dimension like this. If you look carefully at the corner of the screen, you'll see somewhere around 15 or 16% will be mentioned. Now, this means you've actually stretched the canvas and you can see just the 16% of it, right? Previously, it was set at 100%. Now, how to draw a figure for it? So, you must have seen a lot of diagrams like this. These can be easily drawn in PowerPoint, right? Or something like this, which is a flowchart and a schematic representation. So, for convenience, I have taken an example of this, right? So, it shows a substrate that interacts with an enzyme and gets converted into a different product, which is different in color also, right? So what you have to do for this is you go to insert tab and select shapes. There are several shapes already available. If you do not have it, you can always download it and then insert it using this pictures option from it. I have started with a 10-sided polygon, right? And I want to change the color and write in it. So what I do is I click on the right cursor and I get this menu. Now this menu will tell me about format shape, or I can just do it from the convenient menu, which is a shortcut given, and I can change the color of the fill inside and the outline, right? So I've changed it to yellow and I've removed the border. outline of it, and I've written substrate in it, right? And I've added all the shapes in this, and then I change the color to achieve this. Now this is the easiest option. What I suggest you to do is you should actually talk to your supervisor and show them a rough schematic representation that you want to insert. Now this is because you won't have to redo it again and again. So once you get it approved, you can always, you know, draw it in it. Next, we'll talk about graphical representations, right? You must have seen a lot of graphs for different things in research papers, right? So I'm going to tell you how to plot graphs in and add them to your manuscripts. So for graph, you obviously need tabulated data for your x and y axis. So you need MS Excel actually. So you need to open MS Excel, right? And you have to put in your data in it. So this is the kind of graph I'm talking about, which shows the data points and the connecting lines for it. Now this graph actually shows a difference in relative activity of an enzyme at different temperature and pH. So I have taken the data set for, let's assume I have four different samples A, B, C, D, and I have checked their wet weight, right? And I have done this in triplicates. So I have calculated the average wet weight that has come, and I have also calculated the standard deviation for the same, right? So if I have to draw a graph like this, what I need to do is I have to select x and y axis, and then in the chart section you can see there are several options given to you, like a scatter diagram, a pie chart, a column graph, a histogram, and others, right? When you click on it, the scatter one, you'll see something like the similar which was shown before, right? So it has data points and collecting lines to it. Now when you click on it, you get something like this. Now normally a graph without x and y axis or no labeling is useless to us, so we need to add them, right? So for adding, you can see this plus sign over here. When you click it, you get a menu, right, which has a lot of options. Now you need axis obviously, and axis title, you need to mention what is x and y axis. Then we also required a chart title, right? It is not mandatory, but if you want it, right? And then legend means what does these points refer to, right? So I've labeled them, selected them all and labeled them. So now when I have selected them, it will give me option for telling me what the legend means, what is the title of the graph, x and y axis. And I've changed them to samples versus wet weight in grams, and the line shows the average wet weight, and the graph is for wet weight, right? Now if you want to represent the same data in the form of a histogram like this, what we can do is you have to again select x and y axis, go to the chart section. In the chart section you can see a histogram, click on it and select the first option. It will give you a histogram like this, right? Now this histogram again can tell you the x axis but will not tell you what the y axis is. So again you have to select the plus sign and add different sections to it, like axis title. And normally you have to plot standard error or standard deviation for the same, right? So there is an option for error bars. If you click on it, it will again give you a new menu, and when you select on more options, this panel comes up, and by default it will give you a fixed value of let's assume somewhere around 1, right? So it gives you a plus minus 1 error, right? But because I've already calculated standard deviation and I want to plot it, what I'll do is I'll choose custom section and I'll specify the value. So when I click specify value, this kind of a pop-up menu will appear, and it will ask you what the values are. These values, not even the whole row, you actually have to select these values and then click on OK. Now when you see the size of these errors have changed, and you can mention it in somewhere in your manuscript and below the legend of your graph that you are plotting average wet weight with standard deviation. Now this is essential. Why? Because a lot of people plot standard deviation and a lot of people prefer standard error. So it depends on what you have actually calculated and you have to plot it. So I've changed the label and everything and I've mentioned what the x and y axis means, and you can see now clearly, right? The next section is how to draw a table in your manuscript. Now journals do not want tables as a figure. They want table as an editable table into your text. So what you have to do is open your manuscript, right? And wherever you want to insert your table, go there, and there is a section in insert and just below it, it's written table. When you click it, there is a drop down menu, right, which has rows and columns in it, and you have to select them how many you want. Or if you want to insert a table, it's big, let's suppose, and you have a number of columns, so then you can directly say it, right? So I have chosen it like this. It's a 4x6 column table, and I have tried to mention whatever I'm going to put, like corresponding to the previous data that I had plotted. So I'll probably write some number, sample names, and wet weight and dry weight, and whatever I've calculated, right? And to increase the column numbers, you have to click on the right side and you can do it. You can increase the number of rows also, and you can increase the number of columns also. You can insert them in between or after it, right? So it becomes easier for you to actually tabulate it. So it's not actually advisable to insert both table as well as graphs in your manuscript. What you can do is you can make tables separately in Excel, and you can always, you know, copy paste the data over here. But it is advised more that the graphical representations are clearer and easier to understand. So you can decide it and put them inside your manuscripts. And I hope this was useful for you, and thank you very much for listening. And if you have any query, you can always contact me, and I'll try my best to help you. And thank you so much. Stay safe.